السلام عليكم. This is Dr. Rania Sayed, Lecturer of Anatomy and Embryology, Faculty of Medicine, Helwan University. Today we will talk about brain ventricles. What are our objectives today? We should know the brain ventricles, which are the lateral ventricle, the third ventricle, and the fourth ventricle. About each ventricle, you should know its position, its shape, its boundaries, and its relations. We will talk about the tela choroida and the choroid plexus, and lastly, describe the circulation of the cerebrospinal fluid. What are the brain ventricles? They are the cavities which are developed from the neural tube. If you remember, in the development, the neural tube has cavity and has wall. The cavity of the neural tube will be differentiated to form the brain ventricles and the central canal of the spinal cord. If we see, we have two lateral ventricles. This is one lateral ventricle, and this is the other lateral ventricle. There is one lateral ventricle in each cerebral hemisphere. The two lateral ventricles connected together and connected with the third ventricle. Third ventricle, which is the cavity of the diencephalon. They are connected by this foramen, which is interventricular foramen. The third ventricle will continue, its cavity continue downward by the cavity of the midbrain, which is the cerebral aqueduct. And lastly, the last ventricle here is the fourth ventricle, which is the cavity of the rhombencephalon. The fourth ventricle continue downward by the central canal of the lower medulla and central canal of the spinal cord. So these cavities, which are developed from the cavity of the neural tube, are connected together, forming a closed circuit, which are called brain ventricles and central canal. Let's start by this, which is the lateral ventricle. Remember, there is two lateral ventricles. There are two lateral ventricles, one lateral ventricle in each cerebral hemisphere. Okay, now I'll talk about one lateral ventricle, which is this. If you see this lateral ventricle, its shape is about C-shaped. Okay, it extends in the frontal lobe, in the parietal lobe, in the temporal lobe, and in the occipital lobe by what is called horn. So the lateral ventricle has anterior horn in the frontal lobe, posterior horn in the occipital lobe, and inferior horn in the temporal lobe. This area, which is connecting the three horns together, is called central horn or body of the lateral ventricle. Again, this is one lateral ventricle. This is one lateral ventricle. The lateral ventricle are two cavities, two ventricles, one in each cerebral hemisphere. And it is the cavity of the telencephalon. It is the cavity of the telencephalon. Its shape, as we see, it is C-shape. It has this central horn or the body present in which lobe? Yes, in the parietal lobe. And this is anterior horn present in which lobe? Yes, frontal lobe. And this is the inferior horn present in which lobe? Temporal lobe. And this posterior horn extends in the occipital lobe. I want to know that at the junction of the frontal lobe or anterior horn, and the central horn or body of the lateral ventricle, this is the interventricular foramen of Monroe. So the interventricular foramen lies at the junction of the anterior and central horns of the lateral ventricle. Also, this area, which connects the central horn, the inferior horn, and the posterior horn, is dilated area and called trigon or atrium of the lateral ventricle. Trigon or atrium of the lateral ventricle. Okay. So the lateral ventricles has atrium or trigon. Trigon of the lateral ventricle is the site of colons or meeting of the body, posterior and inferior horn. This atrium is the most dilated part of the lateral ventricle. Okay, the central horn continue with the anterior horn. The junction between these two horns are the interventricular foramen. Okay, posteriorly, the central part reaches the splenium of the corpus callosum. Let's we start by the anterior horn of the lateral ventricle. Anterior horn, sorry, here, this is the anterior horn, not the body. Anterior horn of the lateral ventricle. What about the anterior horn of the lateral ventricle? This is the medial surface of the brain, characterized by presence of the corpus callosum. Yes? If we see the position of the anterior horn, it will be here. Here, let's see. This is the anterior horn of the lateral ventricle. This is the anterior horn of the lateral ventricle. Okay. Again, this is the anterior horn of the lateral ventricle. Sorry, anterior horn of the lateral ventricle. Again, the anterior horn present in which lobe? Yes, in the frontal lobe. I want to know that this is the corpus callosum. This is the corpus callosum present in the midline, separating the two cerebral hemispheres. This is here a small membrane, a thin membrane. Thin membrane attached here to the corpus callosum, and this membrane separating the two cerebral hemispheres from each other. This thin membrane is called septum pellucidum. Septum means separate, pellucidum. Septum pellucidum present here. Okay. Behind this septum pellucidum lies the cavity of the lateral ventricle. Lies the cavity of the lateral ventricle like this. This is the cavity of the lateral ventricle extending like that. Okay, so behind this we will find a cavity, which is the cavity of the lateral ventricle. Okay, in the cavity will project the nucleus, which is called caudate nucleus. Caudate, and as we said before, the caudate nucleus is comma shaped or C shaped, has head here. Follow me, and this is the body of the caudate, and ending here in the ancus by the tail and the amygdaloid nucleus. Okay, so if we see here, we'll project the head of the caudate. If we pass posterior, this is the body, will be project also in the body of the lateral ventricle. Okay, so this is the caudate nucleus. If we look here in the midline, we will find these fibers. These fibers is called the fornix. Fornix, it is part of the limbic system connecting numerous nuclei. The fornix has this is anterior column. It's not important, an anterior column. And here, this is the body of the fornix. Body of the fornix. Okay. Now we will talk about the anterior horn. This anterior horn, its cavity, when made a coronal section like this, you will find its cavity is triangular in shape. The same for the anterior horn and the body. Both cavity is triangular in shape. Triangular in shape. Okay. This cavity has roof. Okay. And the floor. This is the floor of the cavity. Or consider the as lateral wall. Floor. Okay. Roof, floor. And the medial wall. Medial wall done by this septum pellucidum and fornix. Okay. Again, I'll talk about the anterior horn of the lateral ventricle. This is the anterior horn. The anterior horn is bounded anteriorly, this point, by the genu of the corpus callosum. And bounded inferiorly by this, this is the rostrum of the corpus callosum. Its roof is formed by the anterior part of the body anterior part of the body of the corpus callosum. Okay, and its floor here, floor is formed by the head of the caudate. Head of the caudate projecting in its wall. Okay, for more understanding, let's we cut here like this. This is a coronal section. Coronal section. If I cut coronal, what I will find? I'll find this. Here's the frontal lobe superiorly. Here, this is the corpus callosum. Which part? This is the anterior part of the body of the corpus callosum. In the midline here, this is the septum pellucidum. And inferiorly here, this is the rostrum of the corpus callosum. This is the rostrum of the corpus callosum. Okay? If I see this cavity, is the anterior horn of the lateral ventricle. Okay? Projecting in it, in its wall, this is the floor, this is the head of the caudate. Head of the caudate nucleus. So the cavity, if you see, it is triangular in shape. Its roof is done by the corpus callosum, anterior part of the body. Its floor or lateral wall, the same, is done by the head of the caudate nucleus. And its medial wall is done by the septum pellucidum. Medial wall done by the septum pellucidum. Again, this is the anterior horn of the lateral ventricle. Its roof done by what? By the corpus callosum, anterior fibers or anterior part of the body. Its medial wall is done by what? Yes, septum pellucidum. Lateral wall or floor is done by what? Yes, it's done by the head of the caudate. Head of the caudate nucleus. And inferiorly here, there is the rostrum of the corpus callosum. Okay, this section is cut like this. Like this. The frontal lobe, the anterior part of the body. Here, laterally, the caudate, head of the caudate, and the medial, the septum pellucidum, and between them, the cavity of the anterior horn. And inferiorly here, there is the rostrum of the corpus callosum. So this area has the boundaries, as we said. Again, the anterior horn of the lateral ventricle, this triangular in cut section, with the same, we will repeat it in the body, it's triangular in cut section. It has roof, floor, and the medial wall. The floor may be considered as lateral wall. The same two lines will be repeated in the body. Okay? It is closed anteriorly by the genu and the rostrum of the corpus callosum. A roof formed of what? Yes, anterior part of the body of the corpus callosum. A floor or the lateral wall formed by what? Yes, head of the caudate nucleus. Head of the caudate nucleus. And inferiorly, there is the rostrum of the corpus callosum. Rostrum of the corpus callosum. The medial wall is done by what? Yes, septum pellucidum. Septum pellucidum. Okay? We complete the here the anterior horn. Now we will take the body. This is the body of the corpus callosum. As I said before, the body is triangular in section, has medial wall here, has floor or lateral wall and roof. You will said the roof is formed by what? Yes, the roof is formed by the body of the corpus callosum. This is the body of the corpus callosum. Okay, the medial wall is done by what? What is this? Yes, this is the septum pellucidum. And what is this? This is the body of the fornix. The body of the fornix. So the roof is done by the corpus callosum body. The medial wall is done by this area, the septum pellucidum. And below here, this is the body of the fornix. The body of the fornix. Okay. If we see, if we remove the medial wall, we will find behind the cavity, and behind the cavity, we will find the lateral wall or the floor. The floor is formed by what? Here, this is the head of the caudate. If you continue, you will find the body of the caudate. So the floor is done by the body of the caudate. If you descend down here, you will find the upper pole of the thalamus. This is the thalamus. This is the thalamus. The upper pole of the thalamus also projecting in the floor or the lateral wall of the body of the lateral ventricle. Let's now cut like this, a coronal section. A coronal section passing by the body. Okay, the corpus callosum. We'll find the frontal lobe. Below it, the body of the corpus callosum, septum pellucidum, the body of the fornix, and here is the thalamus. This is in the midline. Let's we see the coronal section. This is the coronal section. As we said, here is the frontal lobe. Here is the body, the corpus callosum. Here, this is the septum pellucidum. This is the body of the fornix in the midline, and this is the thalamus also in the midline. If we go laterally, we will find the cavity of the central horn or the body of the lateral ventricle, and more laterally, we'll find the body of the caudate. This section in the coronal section is called coronal section of the bodies. As it has the body of the corpus callosum, the body of the fornix, the body of the caudate. Okay? Again, what are the relations or the boundaries of the body of the lateral ventricle? We first said the body of the or the central horn of the lateral ventricle is triangular in shape as the anterior horn. It has roof, floor or lateral wall, and the medial wall. The roof here, this is the roof, okay? And this is the floor or the lateral wall, okay? They meet here laterally at the lateral side, okay? The roof is formed by what? This? Yes, this is the body or the trunk of the corpus callosum. The medial wall is formed by what? What is this? Yes, this is the septum pellucidum. And what is this? Yes, this is the body of the fornix. Okay? This medial wall is common for two ventricles, right and the left. Now, the floor is formed by what? This is the floor or the lateral wall is formed by what? Mainly by the superior surface of the thalamus. This is the thalamus projecting here. This is the superior surface of the thalamus. Okay? Medially. And here laterally, what is this? This is the head of the caudate nucleus laterally. Note that between the body of the caudate and here is the thalamus, these white fibers is called stria terminalis. Stria terminalis is also part of the limbic system. Stria terminalis. These white fibers connecting the thalamus with the caudate are called here stria terminalis. And at this stria, we will find an important vein. This vein is thalamus striate vein, which is draining from its name, the thalamus and the corpus striatum. Okay. Also note that here, this is a space between the thalamus here and the fornix. This space are called choroidal fissure. Choroidal fissure, and from its name, it allows passage of the choroidal plexus between the third and the lateral ventricle. Remember this, and we will discuss the choroidal plexus at the end of the lecture. Okay? Again, tell me about the relations of the body of the lateral ventricle. This is coronal section of the bodies. Here, the body of the corpus callosum. Here is the body of the caudate, here is the body of the fornix, and this is the thalamus. Okay? Tell me about the relations. Firstly, the roof is done by what? Yes, body of the corpus callosum. The medial wall is done by what? What is this? Septum pellucidum. And below here, this is the body of the fornix. The floor or lateral wall is done by what? Yes, this is the superior surface of the thalamus. And here the body of the caudate nucleus. The white fibers connecting here between the caudate and the thalamus is the stria terminalis. And this is the thalamus striate vein draining the internal structures of the brain. Okay. Note that here between the fornix and the thalamus, there is a fissure. This is called a choroidal fissure. This is the choroid plexus of the third ventricle and extended here through the choroidal fissure to reach the body of the corpus of the lateral ventricle. So the choroidal fissure allow passage of the choroid plexus of the third ventricle into the lateral ventricle. Okay. Now what about the posterior horn of the lateral ventricle? This is the coronal section through the occipital lobe. Here, this is the splenium of the corpus callosum. The splenium of the corpus callosum give arching fibers here over the posterior horn of the lateral ventricle. These arching fibers is called tabetum. Tabetum is extension of the splenium of the corpus callosum over and then laterally the posterior horn of the lateral ventricle. So the tabetum here forming the roof of the posterior horn. If we see here laterally, we will find the tabetum. Lateral to it, we will find the optic radiation, which is part of the visual pathway. And more laterally, we will find the inferior longitudinal fasciculus. So laterally here, we will find the tabetum, which are fibers connected to the splenium or the corpus callosum. Optic radiation is part of the visual pathway. The fibers carry the visual impulses. And laterally, the inferior longitudinal fasciculus. The inferior longitudinal fasciculus are long association fibers connecting the frontal loop with the temporal and occipital loops here. Okay, if we see here the splenium bulge inside the cavity of the posterior horn, this bulge is called bulb of the posterior horn. So medially here we will find the bulb of the posterior horn. Okay, this is the floor also showing elevation. One elevation is done by the calcarine sulcus. This is the calcarine sulcus on the medial wall here. Calcarine sulcus will give elevation here in the posterior horn called calcar avus. And only the collateral sulcus appearing on the inferior surface, collateral sulcus here, giving another elevation called collateral trigone. So if we look inside the cavity of the posterior horn, we will find three elevations. First done by the splenium is called the pal of the posterior horn. The second is done by the calcarine sulcus and called the calcar avus. And the last one is done by the collateral sulcus and called what? Yes, called collateral trigone. Again, the posterior horn of the lateral ventricle extended the occipital loop. It has roof, lateral wall, and medial wall. The roof is done by what? Yes, tabetum. The roof and the lateral wall are formed by the tabetum. Tabetum is a sheet of fibers passing from the splenium to the corpus callosum. The lateral wall, which is formed by the tabetum, is bounded by the optic radiation, and inferior longitudinal fasciculus. Okay. What about the medial wall? The medial wall showing two elevations. One is the bulb of the posterior horn. It is done by what? The bulb is done by what? It's done by the splenium of the corpus callosum. And the other is the calcar avus. The calcar avus is done by the calcarine sulcus. There is also another elevation, which is the collateral trigone done by the collateral sulcus. The inferior horn, it is difficult for you, so don't know the relation, but only know that the inferior horn is present in the temporal loop and it has choroid plexus, and I'll talk about it later. So I now in the lateral ventricle. Let's we know about the telechoroida and choroid plexus. I first want to know there is a difference between telechoroida and choroid plexus. The telechoroida is formed of layers. These layers are pyamidal and ebenthymal layer. First, let's see that the entire ventricular system, as we said before, the tube, which is the tube of the neural tube, is lined from interior by epithelial cells. These epithelial cells are called ebenthyma or ebenthymal layer. So all the ventricles are lined by ebenthyma. All the ventricles and the central gland are lined by ebenthyma layer or ebenthyma. Okay? Right. What about the telechoroida? The telechoroida is formed by ebenthymal cells, which is present in all ventricles, and the double layer of the pyamidal. The pyamidal will form double layer inside the ventricle to form what is called telechoroida. What about the choroid plexus? If the telechoroida receives blood supply, receives feeding artery, it changes its name from telechoroida to choroid plexus. So the choroid plexus is a vascularized telechoroid. The choroid plexus is a vascularized telechoroid. Okay? Now the telechoroida is common to the lateral ventricles and third ventricles, as we will see below. Again, this is the third ventricle. Okay, And this is the lateral ventricle. This is the body of the lateral ventricles. If we see here, all the ventricles are lined by ependymal cells. So the ependymal present in all ventricles. Okay, ependymal cells. If we add double layer of dura mater, this is the ependymal cells. If we add double layer of the biomatter, we will form telechoroida. So the telechoroida formed of ependymal cells and double layer of the biomatter. Okay. If we add, this is the biomatter, double layer of the biomatter. If we add blood vessel, we will find choroid plexus. So the choroid plexus is a vascularized telechoroida, a telechoroida receiving a feeding artery. Okay. As we said below, before, here, this is the third ventricle, the cavity of the third ventricle, and this is the body of the central horn of the lateral ventricle. There is a common telechoroida here for the third ventricle and extending here through the choroidal fissure to reach the body of the anterior horn. So the choroid plexus of the third and lateral ventricles are common. Common is one choroid plexus present in the roof of the third ventricle and here in the floor of the central horn of the lateral ventricle. Okay, again, the choroid plexus of the third and lateral ventricle, the choroid plexus of the third ventricle formed by medial and lateral posterior choroidal artery. Don't mention medial and lateral, but no wheel is formed by the posterior choroidal artery. So the telechoroida present in the roof of the third ventricle and in the floor of the central horn of the lateral ventricle has feeding blood vessels from what? From posterior choroidal artery. It's very important. Posterior choroidal artery. Okay? So the telechoroida extend into the central part of the lateral ventricle through the upper part of the choroidal fissure. Okay? There is another choroid plexus present in the inferior horn, to the separate plexus. Another choroid plexus present in the inferior horn of the lateral plexus. And it receives the blood supply or the receiving or the feeding arteries is the anterior choroidal artery, which enters through the inferior part of the choroidal fissure. So we have two choroidal arteries supplying the choroid plexus of the lateral ventricle. The anterior choroidal supplying the inferior horn of the choroid plexus of the inferior horn and the posterior choroidal supplying the choroid plexus of the third and lateral and central horn of the lateral ventricle. Okay? At the trigone, which is the dilated bar connecting the central and the posterior and the inferior horn, there is anastomosis between the two plexuses. Anastomosis between the anterior and the posterior choroidal artery. Okay? What about the anterior horn? The anterior horn of the lateral ventricle doesn't receive any blood vessels. So it is devoid of the choroid plexus. So there is no choroid plexus. There is no telechoroid and choroid plexus present into the inferior, through the anterior horn. The anterior horn is away from the choroid plexus. Okay? Now we will talk about the third ventricle and consider it as a revision for the diencephalon. I want you to stop record and you say by yourself as a revision, okay? Now, what is the third ventricle? The third ventricle is the cavity of the diencephalon. Okay? It is situated in the midline. This is the median cavity situated between the right and the two thalami. The space between the two thalami in the midline is the cavity of the third ventricle. The third ventricle has anterior wall. This is the boundaries of the diencephalon. This is the same boundaries of the diencephalon. The diencephalon has anterior wall, posterior wall, two lateral walls, which is done by the two thalami. Okay, as the cavity is present in the midline, so the lateral wall is done by the two thalami and two hypothalami. Has floor and roof. They are, this boundaries or relation, the same as the diencephalon. Okay, let's revise This is the median surface of the brain. Again, this is the median surface of the brain characterized by presence of the corpus callosum. Okay, this is the septum pellucidum, and this is the body of the fornix. Here in the roof, this is all this, the cavity of the third ventricle. The cavity of the third ventricle. No wheel that. This is the thalachoroida or choroid plexus of the third ventricle. This is the thalachoroida or choroid plexus present in the third ventricle. It is present here in the roof of the third ventricle, thalachoroid of the third ventricle. It extends here in the space between the body of the fornix and the thalamus. This is the space. It extends to reach the central horn of the lateral ventricle. Okay? This is the cavity of the third ventricle. Note that, what about its relation? Anteriorly, it is found by the anterior column. This is the anterior column of the fornix. This is the anterior commissure, and this is the lamina terminalis. Posteriorly, this is the pineal commissure, the pineal gland, and the posterior commissure. Okay, and all of these are parts of the epithalamus. They are parts of the epithalamus. What about inferiorly? Here, this is the tegmentum of the midbrain, tegmentum of the midbrain. Here, this is the posterior perforated substance, mammillary bodies, infundibulum of the pituitary gland, optic chiasma. All these are the structures present in the interpeduncular fossa. This is the cerebral peduncle, and this fossa here is the interpeduncular fossa. Interpeduncular fossa is structured forming the inferior boundary of the diencephalon and inferior boundary of the third ventricle. Okay. What about the lateral wall? The lateral wall here is formed by the stria medullaris thalami, these fibers, stria medullaris thalami. This is the thalamus. This is the hypothalamic sulcus extending from the interventricular foramen of Monroe till downward the cerebral aqueduct, and this is the hypothalamus. So this is the lateral wall formed by thalamus, hypothalamus, and the hypothalamic sulci, and above here, this is the stria medullaris thalami. There is no medial wall, as this is one cavity present in the midline, okay? The roof of the central ventricle is formed by what? It's formed by the choroid plexus and thalachoroida of the third ventricle here, the stria medullaris thalami, and the body of the fornix, as we said before, TFO, TFO. Again, this is the relation of the third ventricle, as we mentioned before. Try it with yourself. Here, this is the lateral wall. It's formed of what? Yes, it's formed by the hypothalamic sulcus, separating the thalamus from the hypothalamus. Okay, the epithalamus also forming a small part of the lateral wall, but it mainly present in posteriorly. The interventricular foramen of Monroe is also seen through the lateral wall. Okay. The anterior wall is formed by what? Yes, by the lamina terminalis, anterior commissure, and the column of the fornix. Posterior wall is formed by what? By structure forming the epithalamus, as we said before. Posterior commissure, hypanular commissure, and the pineal gland. The floor is formed by what? Yes, structures present, sorry, this is the inferior wall. This is not the floor. This is the inferior wall. The inferior boundary, not the floor. The inferior boundary is formed by the optic chiasma, tuberosinarium, infundibular mammillary bodies. This is structure present in the interpeduncular fossa. And finally, the roof is formed by the thalachoroida and the choroid plexus. Okay. What about the communication of the third ventricle? As we said, this is the cavity of the third ventricle. Communicate with the cavity of the lateral ventricle here through the interventricular foramen of Monroe. Interventricular foramen of Monroe, and continue also here with the cerebral aqueduct of Sylvius. So the communication with the lateral ventricle through the interventricular foramen, and with the fourth ventricle through the cerebral aqueduct. Now we will talk about the fourth ventricle. First, know that the fourth ventricle is the cavity of rhombencephalon, the cavity of the rhombencephalon. The rhombencephalon is formed by anteriorly pons and medulla, and posteriorly here, this is the cerebellum. So the cavity is present here, bounded by the pons and the upper part of the medulla anteriorly, and this is forming the floor of the fourth ventricle. And posteriorly here, part of the cerebellum and superior inferior medullary vela, which are forming the floor of the fourth ventricle. If you see that, the fourth ventricle is a diamond in shape, diamond, formed of superior triangle and inferior triangle. Again, the fourth ventricle is the cavity of the rhombencephalon, is ventrally related to the bones and the medulla, which are parts of the fourth of the rhombencephalon, and dorsally related to the cerebellum. What are the boundaries of the ventricle? As we said, it has floor, which is called rhomboid fossa, formed by bones and upper part of the medulla, roof, which is formed by the cerebellum and the lateral wall. What about the floor? This is the dorsal surface of the brain stem. Dorsal surface of the brain stem is divided by these fibers. These fibers, which are called stria medullaris, passing through the rhomboid fossa. It divides the bones or separates the bones above from the medulla below. This rhomboid shape is called the floor or the rhomboid fossa. The rhomboid fossa forms of upper triangle is this, and the lower triangle, which is this. Okay. What are the structures of the rhomboid fossa or the floor of the fourth ventricle? You will find here in the midline, this sulcus in the midline is called median, as it was in the midline, median sulcus. First, we will talk about the posterior surface or the dorsal aspect of the bone. On the side of the medial sulcus, this is fascial colliculus. This elevation is called the fascial colliculus. And you should know that this colliculus is done by the abducens in nucleus. And its name comes as the fascial fibers circle around this nucleus. So the fascial colliculus containing the abducens in nucleus, which is encircled by fascial fibers. Okay? Above the fascial colliculus in the midline here, or in the medial side on both sides, we will find what is called median eminence. Median eminence. Okay, this is the median eminence. If we pass laterally here, we will find the vestibular nuclei. These two vestibular nuclei, and in the medulla also, this is two vestibular nuclei. So this is the vestibular area. Okay, in the lower medulla, this is the median sulcus in the medial, as we said before. Here in the midline, this is the hypoglossal trigone, related to the hypoglossal motor nucleus, hypoglossal trigone. Here, this is the vagal trigone, and laterally the vestibular area or vestibular trigone. This is the upper half of the midline, okay? And this is the rhomboid fossa forming the floor of the fourth ventricle. If we pass laterally, the lateral walls of this fossa or the lateral wall of the ventricle is formed by this. This is the superior cerebellar peduncle, and superior medullary velum. Here, this is the middle, and this is the inferior cerebellar peduncle. Okay, the intermediate part of the fossa is formed by this fiber traversing the both sides, connecting the two loops of the cerebellum, are called stria medullaris. Okay. Inferiorly here, we will find these two nuclei. This is medially the gracile and laterally the caudate nuclei. Gracile and the caudate nuclei forming the inferior boundary of the fossa. Here at the apex here of the diamond-shaped fossa, inferiorly, we will find what is called area posterior or the apex. Apex or the area posterior. And this area is very important as it contains the vomiting center. Okay? The area posterior or the vomiting center. Also note that here, this is area colored blue or dark blue. So it's a name called locus ceruleus. Locus means this location. Ceruleus means dark blue color. As it is colored by this color, it's called locus ceruleus. Okay. Again, what about the floor of the fourth ventricle, which is called rhomboid fossa? The rhomboid fossa divides into three parts: upper triangular part, which is formed by the posterior surface of the bone, and the lower triangular part, formed by the posterior surface of the medulla, and between them, this is the stria medullaris.
The intermediate part containing fibers called stria medullaris. Stria medullaris. What about the posterior surface of the bone? We will find in the midline the median sulcus. Median sulcus. On both sides of the median sulcus, we will find the median eminence. The median eminence. The median eminence to contain the fascial colliculus. Fascial colliculus, which is bound laterally by the sulcus limitans. Sulcus limitans. There also a vestibular area laterally present in both bones and medulla. What about the lower triangle or the posterior aspect of the upper medulla? It contains the hypocrystal trigone medially, laterally the vagal trigone. At the apex, we will find the area posterima or the vomiting center, which is lies at the above the gracile and cuneate. Okay. What about the lateral border? As we said before, look here. This is the floor. This is the floor or the rhomboid fossa. Okay, the cavity of the fourth ventricle is like this. If we see, we will find lateral relation. This extension from these fibers are called superior medullary velum. This is the superior cerebellar peduncle, like this cap. And this velum or roof is called superior medullary velum. The superior medullary velum is well developed like this. It is well developed. Here, this small part is the inferior medullary velum. It is not well developed. Inferior medullary velum. Inferior medullary velum. If we look here, this and this, here this is lateral recess. Recess like a pouch. Okay, this is recess like a pouch or deep area. Okay, here this is lateral recess. This is one lateral recess, and the other side is another lateral recess. So we have two recesses present in the cavity of the fourth ventricle. This is one recess between the superior and the inferior medullary velum here. This is one recess and this is the other recess. Okay. Again, what about the lateral boundary? The upper part is formed by the superior medullary velum and superior cerebellar peduncle. Lower is formed by the inferior cerebellar peduncle and part of the gracile and the cuneate tubercle. What about the roof of the fourth ventricle? The roof here formed by the superior medullary velum. The fibers here extended over here, forming the superior medullary velum and the cerebellum, and here the inferior medullary velum. So this is the superior medullary velum, inferior medullary velum, and between them the cerebellum. This is the roof, as we said before. This is the shape of the cavity of the fourth ventricle. If we look at the shape, we will find recesses, okay? This is one recess and this is the other. These are called two lateral recesses. And in the midline here, this is another three recesses called the median recess and lateral dorsal recess, okay? What is the importance of these recesses? The lateral recess here containing foramen, connecting the fourth ventricle to the subarachnoid space. So there is a lateral foramen present in the lateral recess connecting the cavity of the fourth ventricle to the subarachnoid space for drainage of the content of the CSF into subarachnoid space. This lateral foramen is called the foramen of Loschke, which is the scientist which discovers this foramen. Foramen of Loschke. Don't forget, La Loschke, La lateral. Okay? So what are the recesses? We have two lateral recesses, one on each side, and they contain foramen or lateral aperture of Loschke connecting the fourth ventricle to the subarachnoid space. There's also another recesses, median dorsal and the two lateral dorsal recesses. What about the communication of the fourth ventricle? Note that here, this is the cavity of the fourth ventricle, okay? We have two lateral recesses. Communicate the fourth ventricle with the subarachnoid space, okay? The fourth ventricle also communicates with the third ventricle through the cerebral aqueduct. It also connected downward with the central canal of the spinal cord. And the most important one here, this is the connection with the subarachnoid space here by the foramen of Magillus. Note that the roof is formed by this, the superior medullary velum, and the cerebellum, and this part is the inferior medullary velum. Inferior medullary velum. The inferior medullary velum stops to here, which is not well developed, and make aperture foramen here. It's called aperture of Magendie or foramen of Magendie. It's connecting the fourth ventricle with this space. This is subarachnoid space. But this area is called cistern, and this is dilated. We said before, cistern means dilatation in the subarachnoid space. Dilatation in the subarachnoid space. Okay? So this is dilatation of the subarachnoid space between the cerebellum and the medulla oblongata. So this is called cerebellomedullary cistern. This dilatation called cerebellomedullary cistern. So this area of the subarachnoid space is called cerebellomedullary cistern. Okay. Again, the communication here connected above with the third ventricle, connected below with the central canal, connected laterally to the subarachnoid space through the foramen of Loschka, and connecting inferiorly here by this magnum or this aperture, which of aperture of Magendie. Okay, it's connecting the fourth ventricle to this cistern, which is called cerebellomedullary cistern. Again, what about the communication connected with the central canal and the cerebral aqueduct? Okay, still at the inferior, connected to the foramen of Magendie with the cerebellomedullary cistern, and connected with the foramen of Loschka to the cerebrospinal phloem, to the subarachnoid space. What about the thalachoroida of the fourth ventricle? We have thalachoroida, this is one, and this is the other thalachoroida of the fourth ventricle. If you see this thalachoroida, it is look like T-shape. The two thalachoroids forming T-shape, okay? It has a stem, this is the stem, and having two lateral parts, this is one and this is that, okay? If you see here, the lateral part extend to reach the lateral aperture. This is one lateral aperture and this is the other lateral aperture. The transverse stem or the transverse limb of the T-shape extending here in the two lateral aperture. The vertical limb of the T-shaped structure of the two choroid here extending to reach the median aperture. The median aperture or the foramen of Magendie. Okay, so we have thalachoroida in the fourth ventricle. It forming a T-shaped structure. We are two thalachoroids. This is one right and one left. The two together forming a T-shaped structure. Okay, has horizontal limb. The horizontal limb extending is the lateral recess here through the foramen of Loschka to reach the subarachnoid space, and has median or vertical limb extending through the foramen of Magendie. Again, here, this is the choroid breaker. This is the vertical limb. Okay, and this is the horizontal limb extending here through the lateral aperture, the lateral recess here, and this is the inferior limb extending through the inferior medullary, this is the inferior medullary velum extending through this aperture to the bishop of Magendie to reach the cerebellum medullary cistern. So the thalachoroida or the choroid plexus of the fourth vertex is T-shaped, like this T-shape, has vertical limb and horizontal limb. Receive bleeding vessel from the artery passing here, which is the pica, posterior inferior cerebellar artery. Here is the posterior inferior cerebellar artery, pica, here passing the vertebral artery on both sides to form the basilar artery here, and the vertebral artery giving a branch was like this, which is the pica. The pica give blood supply or innervation to the choroid plexus of the fourth ventricle. If you see here, this is the third ventricle. This is the choroid plexus of the third ventricle, extending here to the choroidal fissure to reach the body of the central horn. The feeding vessel is very important. The feeding vessel of the inferior limb or the inferior horn of the lateral ventricle, it comes from the internal carotid artery, which is the posterior choroidal artery. Anterior choroidal artery. Okay, the feeding vessel for this thalachoroida of the third and central horn of the lateral ventricle is the posterior choroidal artery. And here the feeding vessel is the bica or the posterior inferior cerebellar artery. Again, they are similar in structure to those of the lateral and third ventricle, as they are formed of ependymal layer or ependymal lining. They are covered by two layers of bia mater, and laterally comes or receive the blood supply to devascularize and become choroid plexus. Okay, H plexus, the two plexus, the right and the left, forming a T-shaped structure. Okay, it has horizontal and vertical limb. The vertical limb, as we said, present in the midline and projecting downward through the medial aperture to reach the subarachnoid space at the area of the cerebellomedullary nerve. The horizontal limb, as we said, extending in the lateral recesses and project into the subarachnoid space also. The choroid plexus receiving the blood vessels from the posterior inferior cerebellar artery. Okay. The last objection is the circulation of the cerebrospinal fluid. You will discuss it in details in the physiology, but I want to know that the cerebrospinal fluid is present inside the ventricles, inside the central canal of the spinal cord, and it has circulation. Okay. The circulation begins here in the lateral ventricle. Lateral ventricle, the CSF is formed by the choroid plexus in the lateral ventricle, then passing through the interventricular foramen of Monroe to reach to the third ventricle. The third ventricle, more CSF is added by the choroid plexus in the roof of the third ventricle. Then the CSF passes through the stripper aqueduct to reach the fourth ventricle. In the fourth ventricle, more CSF is added by this T-shaped telachoroidal or choroid plexus. Know that the CSF descend downward from the first ventricle in the central canal of the spinal cord and return back again in the central canal upward to be drained here in the fourth ventricle. So the flow of the CSF in the central canal of the spinal cord is down and then return to ascend upward by the ependymal cells, its motion of the ependymal cells, and also by the anastomosis of the small central canal. So the flow descending down and extending up. Okay? All the CSF collected or passing through these ventricles reach the subarachnoid space. How the CSF inside the ventricle reach subarachnoid space? By two apertures. This aperture, which is called aperture of McGinsey or the median aperture, here passing the CSF to this dilated space, which is cerebellomedullary cistern, cerebellomedullary cistern. This is one way. The other way is through the lateral recess or lateral aperture of Loschka. Now, the CSF passing from the ventricle to reach outside to the subarachnoid space. In the subarachnoid space, the fluid passing all through in subarachnoid space, reaching below here in the lumbar cistern, okay, to reach all the subarachnoid space. Finally, it passes from the subarachnoid space here through arachnoid villi and the granulation into the venous sinus, into the superior sagittal sinus. And you now pass with the superior sagittal sinus to reach it to the venous circulation. From the superior sagittal sinus, okay, collected the blood performing the transverse sinus, and from the transverse sinus passing to the sigmoid sinus, and from the sigmoid sinus to the then internal jugular vein, and lastly to the heart. So now the CSF is drained to the systemic circulation. CSF inside the ventricle, drained to the subarachnoid space by foramen of McGinty and the foramen of Loschka, and the CSF surrounding the subarachnoid space, reaching the venous sinuses through the arachnoid villi here and the granulation of the superior sagittal sinus, and lastly the superior sagittal sinus drain its contents through the other sinuses to the internal jugular. Okay, now I end my lecture. I hope you will understand, and thank you.